G'day everyone. Today in our chemistry help video, we're going to look at equilibrium. Specifically, how do we interpret the graphs? Often this can be difficult for some people, so hopefully this one will help you out. All right, so first of all, just go through a couple of things when it comes to equilibrium. First of all, we need to know this thing called the equilibrium constant. It's really important in guiding our view of our graphs and having a think about what actually happens. Now remember, the equilibrium constant is represented by the letter K. And equilibrium constant itself is derived by getting the concentration of the products over the concentration of the reactants. Now, if it gives us a number equal to 1, at the end of the reaction, when equilibrium is established, we'd expect there to be equal particles or equal amounts of each one. If the number is less than 1, then what we would expect is there to be much more in terms of reactants. If it's greater than 1, we'd expect there to be many, many more products. In practice, we're looking at, say, 1,000 to 10,000, something like that. That means there's equal amounts, but overall, we look at numbers that are very small or very large, guiding our equilibrium constant discussions. If we look at a reaction like the Haber process, a really common one, and we're going to use this example all throughout this video because it is an industrial process, it's very important, and it is easy to use to help us look at changes to equilibrium. Now, to calculate the equilibrium constant for the Haber process, we first of all, of course, need our reaction. 3 hydrogen molecules plus 1 nitrogen molecule makes 2 ammonia molecules. It's an, as you can see, it's an exothermic process because energy is released as a product. Now, to calculate the equilibrium constant, we've got to remember it's ammonia, but it's to the power of 2 because we need to take into account the coefficient from the reaction. Divided by the hydrogen to the power of 3 times nitrogen to the power of 1. And that gives us our equilibrium constant. Okay, a couple of quick points about equilibrium constants and equilibriums, just as revision. Only substances in aqueous or gaseous form are included in the equilibrium constant. Liquids and solids are not. That's really important. Never include those in an equation. And linking to that, only factors that affect the components in the equilibrium expression can affect equilibrium. So, for example, there's no solid in an equilibrium expression. So if you add more solid, it's not going to make any difference. Same with liquid. Essentially, these substances, we treat them as if they're in excess, so there's already too much. So adding or taking a little bit is not going to make a great difference. But we'll get into special cases in another video. Another thing to remember is that the equilibrium constant is just that. It's a constant. That number has to be. So if we do something to the system will attempt to move in such a way to counteract the change and re-establish the equilibrium constant. We've got to keep that number a constant. And that's what guides all the behavior. Now, when we're talking about what happens or how it works, we've got to remember that in year 12 chemistry, we need to use collision theory in all of our explanations. We can't use Le Chatelier's principle. LCP can be used as a guide to help us predict, but we can't use it anymore to help us explain. A lot of older textbooks, older websites or resources produced in the WACE or TE even days, they use LCP a lot to explain things. We can't do that in the current course. Okay, so let's look at the 3 different things that can affect equilibrium. Now we look at concentration, or we can look at pressure, or we can look at temperature. Now, for each of the 3 examples, I'm gonna use the same as graphs or same grids. So here's our reaction, the Haber process. As I said, it's an exothermic process in the forward direction. Now, what we have is a rate graph with reaction progress, with the solid line being the forward and reverse being dotted, or we have concentration. Now, these positions here are arbitrary. What we're just trying to show is separate them enough so you can see what happens. But if I had ammonia at the bottom and nitrogen top, it wouldn't make any difference. It's an arbitrary placement. This one, the rates, forward and reverse, they need to be on the same. They are the same at equilibrium. Now, I've separated them a bit just for clarity, but imagine in real life, they would actually be overlapping. Okay, so our first example of how to interpret the graph is we're going to change the concentration. Let's say the hydrogen, all right? So what happens? If we inject more hydrogen into the system, we increase the concentration of that graph. That means that particles involving this particular element will be increased, which means there's more collisions between hydrogen and anything else that's involved with, in this case, the nitrogen. So the concentration of particles as reactants has increased. So that means that the rate of the forward reaction will immediately increase because there are more collisions. The reverse rate, the ammonia, has not been changed. So its rate will not be affected in any way. So that stays where it is, down here. Now, as time passes, the collisions between hydrogen and nitrogen decrease because it's being consumed. And we represent that like this. So as the graph goes down, it's because the hydrogen and the nitrogen are being consumed and making more ammonia. So less collisions, rate goes down. Now, as you make that more ammonia, its collisions go up. So it climbs. And what happens is eventually we get to a situation where the forward rate, once again, equals the rate of the reverse rate reaction, and that's equilibrium. So the forward rate went up, reverse was unchanged, forward rate dropped, reverse rate grew, and new equilibrium at a higher rate. Why is it a higher rate? Because there are more particles literally in the system. We injected more, so we can't take any away. Okay, so that's the rate graph. Now concentration, we need to have a look at what happens to each individual species. So first of all, hydrogen goes up. That's the green line. What happens then? As time goes on, it's consumed. So we need to look at it go down as it's consumed. Now, because it's being consumed, the hydrogen is also, nitrogen is also being consumed. It's being used up in its reaction with hydrogen. What's important though, is that there's a 3 here and a 1 there. So we need to represent that here. It's a 3-to-1 ratio, approximately, in terms of my graph. What is also important is I can never, ever completely counteract the change. I can't get rid of it all. So that line must never go below this line. Now, as the hydrogen and the nitrogen are being consumed, what also happens is ammonia is being produced and it grows. Now, there's a 2 in front of that, so we try to represent that with our curvature as well. And eventually what happens is that as the hydrogen and nitrogen are consumed and the ammonia is produced, we eventually get to a point where the forward rate equals the reverse rate and we plateau out again. And you can see that the concentrations reach new absolute amounts. So that's what happens when you change concentration in an equilibrium situation. Right, next we're going to have a look at pressure and see what happens with pressure. All right, so first of all, what are we going to do? Oh, less tire this time. We'll halve the volume, which will increase the pressure. So that's going to be our problem for this one. So what happens with our rate and our concentration graphs? All right, so if we halve the volume, we increase the pressure. That means there are more collisions between all the particles. So you're going to get an increase in the rate of both the forward and reverse reactions. But because there's more particles on the reactant side, it's going to get a greater increase in the number of collisions between the reactant particles. So it goes up more. Over time, those collisions, which are increased, will eventually decrease because we are consuming the nitrogen and the hydrogen, so its rate will go down. As you make more ammonia, its rate goes up. So it's already been elevated because it's been squeezed into a smaller space, but as you make more of it, then it's going to increase as well, and eventually we get that classic equilibrium being re-established at a higher rate because it's in a smaller space. This is how it's re-established. But what happened, as opposed to the previous graph, is that both rates went up to start. Now, in terms of our concentration changes over here, what happens is that there has been no individual change, but what I did was I decreased the volume, so the concentration of all three went up. Okay, so all three had to go up because I squeezed the space. But the forward reaction overtook the reverse reaction because there are more collisions. So as the forward reaction overtakes the reverse reaction, the ammonia is produced as the forward rate here progresses. The hydrogen is consumed and the nitrogen is consumed. But again, watch those coefficients. 3 for hydrogen, 1 for nitrogen, so a different curvature. And eventually we end up with that plateauing effect and we have equilibrium re-established. Now, with a pressure change like this, what's really important is on the concentration graph, all three spike. On the previous example, on the concentration thing, only one spiked, which was the thing we changed. In this case, all three. That's how you recognize a pressure change. All right, so if you look for the spike, all three, or all the components, that's probably gonna be pressure change. Okay, so that's that one. So our last example is we're gonna increase the temperature. All right, now if we increase the temperature, we give more kinetic energy to all the particles. We also have more particles that have sufficient energy to overcome the energy barrier, the activation energy. So we get more particles with successful collisions, faster reaction rate for both. Now, because the endothermic reaction is consuming energy, it's using energy essentially as a reactant in the reverse direction, it gets a double kick. The forward reaction doesn't get that double kick. It gets the kinetic energy boost, activation energy boost, but not the using the energy as a essentially a reactant. So the reverse one goes up more. So as time goes on, the forward reaction is sped up, but the reverse reaction coming this way is sped up more. So what we get is eventually the ammonia is consumed, we're making more hydrogen and more nitrogen, so its rate goes up, and again, we end up with a new absolute rate much higher than before, because all the particles are moving faster, more energy, all that sort of stuff. So there's our rate graph. Now, with our concentration, it's really important. With concentration, we don't increase the number of particles at all by changing the temperature. So we can't get any spikes, because getting spikes would mean we've added more. We can't do that. But what's happened is as the reverse reaction is favored, we're making more nitrogen, we're making more hydrogen at a 3-to-1 rate, and we're consuming ammonia. So we get no spikes. We get a more gradual change. You're not going to get any instant changes in concentration. It's going to be gradual as the forward rate or reverse rate, depending on the situation, is enhanced. All right, so that's how temperature works. Each graph's a little bit different, and it's really important that you understand the differences between concentration, pressure, and temperature. And hopefully this video has given you a little bit of a hand. So hopefully that works for you guys, and I hope you've enjoyed this one. Thanks very much. And just a bit of a shout out to my subscriber, Mitch. This one's dedicated to you, mate. Good luck.